Thank you very much for the invitation, and Michael for bringing me along this Airway group. I'm Rasmus Hesselfeldt. I'm a consultant anesthetist at Rigshospitalet, and normally I do ENT anesthesia, some trauma leadership, and some prehospital care in my loads of spare time time I have from doing all the other stuff. Okay, so this is a very tough crowd. It's very tough to come after these talks. Rich, Michael, Søren, and I thought I wanted to bring some really sexy new stuff for you. So I decided to go with the Supraglottic Airways. Anyone disappointed? Okay. Do you use Supraglottic Airways? Hands up. Okay, a lot of you. Yeah. Are you quite comfortable with it? It seems like an easy, safe procedure to do. Hands up. Anyone? No? Okay, a little less. Definitely, only half of the events before. Oh, that's good. So I wanted to do with the Supraglottic Airways, I want to take a step back and just have a chat about some of the basic stuff we do on a regular basis every day, and just highlight some of the pitfalls that might be into it and why it's actually doable and a very good equipment still. I promise you there will be a short life hack in the end. Yeah, definitely. So why is it relevant for all of us? Some of you might not use Supraglottic Airways every day or be in an institution where you intubate because it's whatever you're in the theaters. But what's relevant for all of us is that it's all in the guidelines, right? Anyone nodding? Nodding? Shaking your head? So this is just the DAS guidelines. But I mean, even in the Vortex approach, which is quite pragmatic, is like it's scheduled there for with a picture of an LMA on it. So it's all within the guidelines, and we all train during our training. Yeah, you do this, you do that, and then all of a sudden you put in a Supraglottic Airway. Does that sound familiar? Yeah. And there's reasons for that as well, which is good. So what can the Supraglottic Airway do? It can buy us time. In the emergency settings, of course, in the elective care, it's a different thing, but now it's can buy us time. But the thing is that inserting a supraglottic airway is a blind procedure, or most of it is. And I want to highlight to you and stress that it is actually shown that in 71, or it varies a lot from the studies, but anyway, it's quite high, okay, that it's suboptimal positioned. For some reason. And this is some of it. Like it's hyperinflated, it's misplaced, it's too, it's the wrong size, it's either squeezing or pressing the epiglottis. But still, it's actually shown, so why do we use it all the time? Because it works. So success for ventilation the first time is actually very good, despite what I just showed you. So we are not aware of what it looks like down there, but it works for ventilation, which is good. So I took this along just to emphasize some of the, just to have that in mind, so everyday things we use. And that figure there is even in the Airways 2 trial, which is a pre-hospital trial, you know, probably more blood, probably more vomit, different setting. But they showed like that was like 4,000, 5,000 patients. And the success of ventilating on an IGL, I think that was an Airways 2 trial, was extremely high. In my experience, it is not that high when I try it. But anyway, so that was thousands of patients, and it was a randomized controlled environment. Okay, so that's quite high. Okay, so that's one thing. Michael talked about the combined techniques, and I want to move a little bit along that road. So once it's in, it might be in some kind of suboptimal position, but we can ventilate, and that's why we can use it as a bridge to something more definitive. All right? So now we're back in the emergency situation. We have put in the supraglottic airway device. We have some kind of degree, some like moderate or acceptable saturation, and we can move on, okay? And we can try and intubate, and that's in all the algorithms as well, try and intubate through the supraglottic airway. We used to have a device for that. How many of you, hands up, still have the fast-track ILMA device in your trolleys? Very few. I looked into it when it was. I'm not exactly sure today why it was removed. Like, why was it so unpopular? Because we moved to this instead, an intubation through that. Okay? Is that something you train a lot? Is that simple procedure? Hands up. Anything intubating through it? Okay, very few. So that's one thing. It's one thing that's in the guidelines. We don't train it a lot. There might be pitfalls to it as well. So it's not something you do every day. So I know there's various techniques. I want to show you just one technique that you can ventilate at the same time as you're intubating. We can try that in the workshop, and I acknowledge there are different ways to do it. Okay, short video. Okay, so they put in some kind of supraglottic airway, and they insert the tube inside the supraglottic airway. They inflate the cuff. They put the ventilator back on and ventilate, oxygenate. Okay, so we continuously oxygenating the patient, ventilating. Capnography is still good. And please watch, this is a two-person job. So you need to train, but you need to train your assistants as well. Extremely important, always train your assistants, okay? Because they play a vital role in how this is going to bite. You don't need to clip the membrane, you just lubricate very well and it will go in. Yeah, there you go. Remember to uncuff it again. Yeah. Railroad, cuff, control position, ventilate, easy. Yeah. So I know that, just to show you, this is a one method of doing it. We did a study on 100 patients, consultant anesthetist tried this. They failed in 8 out of 100. And after the 92 it was left, they managed, while they were asked to pull out the laryngeal mask, you know, there's various techniques. I'm not going to show you that now. We can try that in the workshop. You can use a McGill forceps. You can use a different tube, like exchange catheters, whatever. They managed to extubate the patients 3 times during that. So that is a high-risk procedure, following that we just saved the patient putting the tube down. I'm quite sure that the UK and US and other people know the entry catheter to this. So instead of putting down the tube, you insert your flexible scope inside what looks like a bigger lumen exchange catheters. You use the same technique. Again, two-system job. You put that in, you pull the whole thing out, and you railroad the tube down. I have no video there. Okay. So what could maybe potentially be some kind of assistance for what I've just showed you? Some tried the video LMA. So this is called the third generation. So there's the first generation, second generation. This is the third generation, it's called. So the trick is that you have a multiple use camera that you insert in a tube down the side, right side of the... So it's actually looking at the right side here, and then a disposable laryngeal mask. So the first time success rate, again, extremely high for insertion, which means, again, ventilation was good. Down the go, ventilation, happy days. However, once they evaluated it, they looked at the only visual light, the glottis, in 8 cases out of 100. After first insertion, but they were actually managed to, due to the camera, to manipulate it to get the better view. Okay? So maybe not like you do the same flaws as you do with the other devices, but you maybe have a better chance of manipulating and seeing what you're actually doing after the third, after you wiggling it around. Again, short video. And look, she just asked to put it in. And can you see the screen down here? It's not very recognizable, is it? Just insert it. There's a camera there. If I put a flexible scope down there, I would potentially go just the mucus or and then see. Okay, so wiggle it around and doing, you know, the jaw thrust, grabbing up in the right corner, grabbing during a jaw thrust, and there you go. They're all pointing. Right. Tube. Photobomb. Always an idiot doing that, isn't it? Photobomb again. Yeah, there you go. That's me. And down the tube goes. It's pretty easy once in the right spot, and you have a definitely a better... and you can add on a flexible scope on top of that. So you can use a flexible scope and this. Okay. We need a mouth opening to put in a supraglottic airway. We're all aware of that normally. So I'm just going to show you continuous on what Michael just showed you before, the life hack. So this is lady, she's got a limited mouth opening, and her nose is not usable for the intubation. She went for elective procedure. And this is again where we can sometimes use the combined techniques. Michael just showed you successful ventilation on an anesthetized or unconscious patient. So this is done with an awake patient, sedated, maybe a little bit, but topicalized as well. Same picture, tube tip down through the mouth, okay? So topicalize as you would for your awake intubation. Insert the tube, find the right spot, maybe do a little bit of suction, put in the flexible scope, and potentially you will end up in the right spot. Potentially. Short video again. It's quite limited. Local anesthesia. Yeah, produce your tongue. Yeah. And now, the life hack. Okay, which is cough inflation. So a lot of cough inflation, retract it a little bit, turn it downwards, and you're in the right spot. She was biting, so the tube, so it's a little bit difficult. But anyway, she's just, I've done it recently with a traumatic patient, had a maxillary fracture. The bleeding was controlled, but he was still bleeding. He was spitting, he was sitting up, he was controlling his airway, he could clear, he was coughing. I didn't give him any sedation at all. He was sitting more upright. Intermittent suction, a little bit of local anesthesia, and we managed to do the same thing awake. Instead of doing some kind of high-risk procedure or retrograde or something, we just did the same thing, tube down, topicalization. He accepted it very well. Okay. So something to try in the workshop as well. Okay. So supraglottic airway, ventilation rate is good, but often suboptimal position. Be aware. I'm not saying that what you should do with it, just be aware. Third generation may provide option for evaluation and correction, and tube tip technique can be a valuable option in limited mouth opening. Thank you very much.